Hello and welcome to our Insightful Baby podcast. My name is Diana.
And I am Maria.
And we are your hosts. We have created a brand new community for all of the hustlers, the dreamers, the outsiders, the visionaries out there. Coming from a Hispanic tradition of beliefs, we've decided to share our entrepreneurship journey, ups and downs, and inspire, empower, and help others who are not being themselves because of fear or because of traditional beliefs. Hello, guys, and welcome back to Insightful Baby podcast. Today we are so excited to have a special guest with us today. Her name is Michelle and she is a success coach. Hi Michelle, how are you doing today?
I'm good, ladies. Thank you for having me.
So Michelle, tell our listeners a little bit about yourself, who you are and what you do.
Sure. My name is Michelle Gomez. I am an author, speaker, and a career coach, most commonly known as the Latina career coach. What I do is I help women achieve new heights of success by developing a career strategy to find work that they love and build a life that matters to them.
When we first spoke, you mentioned imposter syndrome. Now, that was a topic that was totally new for me. Like, I had never heard of it, but I've had experienced it before. What are some indicators?
The level of excellence is going to be found in anything you do. How you do one thing is how you do everything. So it doesn't matter what name is on the paycheck. It's you and the brilliance that you bring in. So if you are solely focused on someone else's opinion of you because you think that that's the only part of your identity where you can find self-confidence, you could be struggling with imposter syndrome, okay? Another indicator is if you have a wall full of accomplishments, you know, and by all, like anyone else looks at your life and they're like, man, she's doing it. Like she is killing it. She's out there doing her thing. And you still look at yourself in the mirror and you're like, how did I get here? This is so not my life. I didn't deserve any of this. Like, they're totally going to figure me out and fire me tomorrow. Like, you know, like you're just afraid that the talent police is going to come over to your office and like, tap you on the shoulder and be like, Maria, Diana, we figured you out. You got to go. So that's imposter syndrome. Mm-hmm. And then if you do put so much so much reliance on the outside world to tell you about your value, that's an imposter syndrome struggler's main concern. It's like, as long as everyone else thinks I'm great, then it shouldn't really matter what I think because I just need them to be fooled another day. And so those are some of the key indicators.
Oh, I see. Okay. I mean, I think I've to be totally honest, I've struggled with that before. Like I've had, you know, especially nowadays with like social media and things like that, that, you know, people always put like their highlight reel out there. And, you know, it's hard for you to be honest with people and for to have people actually see what you're going through or things like that, you know. But, I mean, I don't want to say it was to that extent, but I did struggle with, like, having people think maybe, okay, I don't want them to think I'm, like, having a hard time or things like that, you know, because you don't want to worry anyone. Mm-hmm. But I think that's one of the things that is hard to go through when dealing with things like that. But, I mean, that's amazing what you said because nobody should be able to take your validation from you. You know, you should have that within you already. Like it should be ingrained and you should have grace within yourself.
Right. So you know this already, right? You felt this.
Yeah.
So imagine adding another layer of complexity to that by adding the whole cultural implications of being Latina and being ambitious. And you're going into spaces where maybe you're the first Latina or you're the first woman to want to do something. Then it's even more of an indicator, like I'm an imposter, I'm a fake because the only people who have done what I'm doing don't look like me, don't have the background that I have. You know, they were privileged or they came from money or they had connections or, you know, they went to an Ivy League school. I didn't, you know. So there's so many things that also cloud that experience for an ambitious Latina, an ambitious woman of color. So that's why I bring the dynamic of both the cultural implications with the studies behind imposter syndrome to really frame how I coach my clients.
How can someone deal with the tradition? You know, a lot of women out there are afraid of breaking the family tradition. So how can women out there deal with that? Or have you seen that with other people?
All the time, actually. We're so much, let's start here, ladies. So first and foremost, the traditions behind our cultures are beautiful, right? There we have a long line of Latinidad is so much more than just a thing. It's music, it's food, it's traditions, it's strength, it's courage, it's so much, it's music, it's art, it's so much, right? And so, of course, we want to hold true to our traditions because we value those things, right? Mm-hmm. And we want to keep family close. So what I have seen is these brave individuals now that are breaking the cord and kind of like, I'm going to do it my way. And they know it. They do it at the sense of, I'm going to upset people. Some people are not going to get it. And I have to be okay with that, right? Mm-hmm. It does take a sense of bravery. We're talking about women who've decided not to get married and have children. Latinas who are like, no, I'm going to go and get this master's degree and I live in an apartment with my cat and I'm totally happy. That's my life. I love it, right? Mm-hmm. And you have men who've decided to, you know, not take care of their mothers. You know, they decided like, I'm just going to live my life. I'm still struggling to pay my own bills. I don't, can't afford. And I'm not going to live in a box so that I can, yeah, my mom can brag to people about how I take care of her. You know, there's a dynamic change. And there's so, even so many Latinas who don't follow like the being super close to your mom. Right. And they're like, I'm, you know, I love my mom, but I'm not like super attached at the hip to her because I have my own life. You know, yeah, the whole putting your husband before your parent kind of thing is still kind of taboo. People are like, oh, yes, your husband before me. Like, I'm your mom.
Yeah. How dare you?
Right. And so it does. It's going to take bravery. But this is why I, in my coaching of clients, we do a lot of internal work, transformational work, to make sure that you are okay with you, because you can't be for everyone. You're not going to please everyone. And the more you please everyone else, the less fulfilled you're going to be at anything you do. Even if you achieve something, you achieved it so that someone else can brag for you, or someone else can be like, oh, take credit, or feel like, oh, you're filling their cup. You have to fill your own cup first, so that you're not giving from a place of lack, right? If you fill your cup, then what people get from you after that is abundance. It's like, oh, I have extra, so I'm going to give to you, right? But if you don't take care of you first, it's going to make for a very unfulfilling life. Now, like I said, people don't understand. Your family may not get why you want to do it differently. They might take offense to it. And but if you fill your cup and you can express love and honor in different ways. Like if your parent says, well, I would feel honored if you would have given me grandchildren by now, you know, or if you would have gotten married, you know, you're 25, you should be married by now. Like you look a certain way because you're not, you know, and there's so many ways to dishonor our parents. Not getting married by 25 is not one of them. So you being a productive, responsible member of society every day shows honor to your family, shows honor to those that you love. So just because you didn't succumb and force yourself to fit their mold of what you should be, could be, would be, should have by now, doesn't mean you're not bringing honor, because there's so many others. We see it across all culture all the time. We have friends, we have family members in and out of prison, family members in and off the streets, you know, the addictions, you know, there's so many things that bring shame already to the family. You're not doing any of that. You're just deciding to pave your own path. So just be in perspective of how you could be damaging, but you're not, and be okay, be brave enough to say, I'm going to do it this way.
Yeah. And it so happens, you know, that sometimes you decide to do your own thing, but we all know when it comes to family traditions, they're, especially in the Latino community, it's very tough. So yeah, they usually, you know, yes, family members usually blame it on the person who decided to just go for themselves, you know, who decides to just do whatever they wanted to do.
Yeah. And how dare you go on a vacation and not invite us?
Yes. Yeah. Like when you decide to go on vacation and all the family calls you up and, hey, why didn't you invite me? Like, ¿por qué? Da, 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 right? So it's like a drama kind of thing. Talk about telenovelas, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it happens a lot. I've seen it. I've experienced it myself. And, you know, it's horrible, right? Because it's family. So you never expect your own family to blame you for something that you really had nothing to do.
Well, and you know what's so interesting about that, Maria, is we have such a, like, you know, ingrained messaging about family and how you have to do it this way. You can't forget everyone else. And if you push forward for yourself, you're being selfish, right? But I also find it on the flip side that now in this time that we're in, where we have things like open communication, forgiveness, understanding, you know, and how we, even in a corporate culture, when you have a grievance or you have a problem with someone, there's a protocol, right? Like, okay, you bring it to HR. We're going to have a third party witness here. We're going to talk it out. We're going to put it on record that we talked about this, figure out a resolution, and we're going to move forward. Why? Because we're spending 40 plus hours a week in this office together. We have to figure out a way to be together, be productive, get the job done, and not let this minor, you know, personality conflict create a problem in our careers, right? If we do that in a corporate setting, why is it that we can't do it in a familial one? Like, I think it's hilarious when family's like, tradition. And I'm like, really? Well, you haven't spoken to so-and-so in 8 years. Like, you're still mad about so, you're still mad about like, this tia who didn't invite you to her daughter's quince. Yeah. Like, you're cool with her to her face, but the minute she leaves, you're not, you know? And there's this like weird competition. And so I think it's funny how now we're like, we have these traditions that are, they're sort of like set, like, okay, I want you to follow through with this one because it makes me feel good, but don't make me now succumb to what you think I should be doing, like forgiving and not letting go of resentment and, you know, moving forward. So I think it's funny. It's like, you can't pick which part of our culture we should stick to and negate some of the fundamental stuff like love. Like, accepting people no matter their differences.
Respecting.
Unconditional of respect. Like, how about respect the family that decided to take a family vacation, just the four of them, because they actually wanted to bond without any exterior, you know, energies or opinions or have to worry about making sure everyone's having a good time. Yeah. Just respect that this is what they needed and be happy for them. Good for you. You guys on a vacation, that's awesome. I bet you create a lot of memories. That's great. Like, you know what I mean? The fundamental stuff seems to be lacking, but yet the hardcore traditional, you do it my way so that I can brag on you. That's still here.
Yeah, definitely. I get, like, I feel like, like most of those things should be implemented into us as well. Like you said, you know, like, I feel like even just doing something out of the ordinary, I think what it is with parents, like, especially like the Latino culture, I feel like they feel like, oh, okay, first, disrespected, right? And then second of all, it's like they always want to be in control. So if you're doing something, they're like, well, I don't know what she's doing here. Let's say you decided to start your own business. Like, they're like, okay, she's starting her own business. I don't know how to help her with that. So I can't control her in that sense. So now I'm losing control of her life, and now I don't know how to help her. And I feel like that's what it is a lot of the times.
Yeah. Well, and then remember when our parents weren't given a ton of space to fulfill their own dreams, they tend to want to live out vicariously through us. And so the minute your dreams differ from what they wanted, they like you said, they lose control. So they're like, now they feel like their position in your life is threatened in some weird way, right? So I think that's why when I do work with Latinas in a career space, it's like, what are we going to make, what do we have to do to fulfill your dreams? What is your vision of success? Because here's the thing. We're now raising another generation of young Latinas. And I don't want our daughters to feel like they have to live for us. Like, no. Mommy went out. I did my thing.
Yeah.
I wrote the book. I got the education. I visited this place. I spoke to the people. Like, I'm good. Now you find your path. Okay. Don't worry about me. If you need any help or want any advice, I'm here. But, you know, honey, I birthed you, but this is your journey. You got to go out there and figure it out and live life based on what you want to be, you know, and don't do it for me. And so that's why when I do talk to women in our space now, it's like, okay, let's not talk about mom. Let's not talk about, you know, what you think you're pushing forward for your child. The best thing we could do for our daughters is to heal ourselves and fulfill our own dreams so that they can see what that's like and have the courage to go out and do it themselves. Live on their own terms.
Yeah, totally. Totally agree with that. And I feel that maybe this new generation that's coming up, do you think it's going to be like the change for the traditional beliefs and all of that with the Latino community?
Gosh, I think that we will figure out a mix of certain factors as a tradition that work for us, you know, because we want to keep certain things, but we want to change certain things. Like, you may want to keep, you know, celebrating Dia de los Muertos. You may want to keep, you know, making certain foods and practicing certain things in your family, right, that are important. But you may want to let go of things that you're like, I never really agreed with that, you know, like I'm not really cool with that, you know, and do it your own way as sort of a, I'm thinking of the word in Spanish. I'm trying to think of it in English. When you're kind of like defiant.
Oh, okay. I get you.
Okay. No estás haciendo caso. You know, like you're being defiant, but you're
like
doing
criada.
Yeah. Eres mi criada, right? But you're doing it with a purpose, right? Like, exactly. I will continue to, I mean, I celebrate Dia de los Muertos with my children. We make traditional Mexican foods. We celebrate Cinco de Mayo. We practice the Spanish traditions around Christmas and New Year's and stuff like that. You know, we eat the grapes. We do all that, right?
Yeah.
And I want to make sure my children speak Spanish. They're so stubborn, but I'm trying. I really am. I'm trying to keep them so hard. But like this whole, I have experiences in my family where like familial breakdown has happened. And we don't talk to certain families anymore. And certain family members and we show resentment and we disconnect and we exclude people. And I'm like, we're not doing that here. You know? So when my girls get into a little tiff or whatever, I'm like, okay, girls, give each other some space, but you're sisters. And at the end of the day, you don't have to like each other, but you will love each other. You will respect each other. And you're going to work it out. You apologize to this one. You apologize to this one and you move on, because in this family, we don't hold grudges. Mm-hmm. And that's like my big thing with my girls. Cause I'm like, no, I come from a long line of grudge holders.
Yes.
We're not doing that anymore. You know, I mean, I differentiate, of course, there's some relationships that are so toxic that you have to remove yourself, of course. But if it's just like a difference of opinion, or you're not being able to control someone's decision-making, or even if you don't agree with somebody's decision, it's like, okay, we'll be able to talk it through. Like, I don't agree with that. But I love you, and exactly. I don't like that you did that, but I love you, and I'm here, you know? That's family. Like, family should be the jungle gym of love. This is where you practice love. This is where you drop the ball over and over and over, and you pick it up again, and you sweat, and you cry, and you know, it's like, that's where it should be, but it's not happening. So, again, I'm removing certain traditions, but keeping the ones that I think are valuable. And I think that's what's so great about being a brave malcriada as you move on, like, you know what? I'm going to take this with me. I'll put that in my basket. I'm going to leave that other way here. I'm not taking that.
It goes hand in hand with like writing your own rules, you know, like your own family is going to have your own rules. Like my family, like my parents had their own set of rules. And then my kids, I saw some things that my parents did. I'm like, I don't want to do that because I know what damage that did to me. So that's what I want to work on with my kids. So I think like, throughout the generation, the rules are going to be changing. And as long as we keep the beliefs that are like strong to your family, like you said, celebrating Dia de los Muertos, you know, I have a big tradition with my family to celebrate New Year's Eve. Like that's our thing. We love New Year's Eve. We're like that crazy family that goes outside in like the suitcases, like for traveling, and we eat the grapes, you know, things like that. Like that's our tradition. And that's something that I want to keep. But of course, you know, just you have to write your own rules.
Yeah, for sure. And it's hard. You're going to piss people off, but.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, well. Eres malcriada. Go be malcriada.
As long as you're doing the right thing for you.
Exactly.
Your life. And you got to look back at it and decide, did I really stay true to myself? And that's why the transformational work that I do with my clients, it's more about everything you need is inside of you. You just spend so much time worrying about what everyone else thinks that you don't listen to that voice first. So it's about owning your brilliance, owning that voice and listening, because she knows what she wants.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So overall, you know, it's just make sure that you put yourself first, I would say. Right.
I know it sounds selfish. Trust me, I do. I understand it sounds selfish, but you can't be for anyone if you don't take care of you first.
Yeah.
Really. I mean, it's self-care, self-reflection, being able to change how you speak to yourself about yourself.
Yeah.
That's where the foundational work comes with anything. So that way into success, into academics, you know, career, into any project you're working on, you know, you go into it with a sense, because you know, I'm good at this. This is what I'm good at. And I'm going to tackle it well. And I trust myself to make the best decision for me right now. And But that's the thing. We don't learn to trust ourselves. We don't trust the voice inside. And we give the voice away too quickly.
Yeah. And I know sometimes it's hard to even, I mean, this goes like going back into your family and how you were raised, but sometimes we don't even have like the parents to be able to have trust in. So it's hard for us to trust other people. So I was never like, I was never told like, I love my family, of course. And I know they never meant to hurt me or anything like that. But like my mom or my dad, they never taught me like, hey, you know, go and chase your dreams, or if you want to do this, do them. Or if you want to live a certain way, go ahead and live that certain way. Like I was always just kind of told like, okay, you need to go to school and you need to like, I believe we were talking about this earlier, but yeah. I was always had those beliefs in me, like, and they were engraved in my head. So whenever I thought like I started seeing other things and I started believing in other things and just kind of seeing what's out there, I thought like I was feeling like the outcast of the family, you know, or like things like that. So that's one of the things that I struggled with a lot. And I feel like you helping other women get over kind of these situations, I think that's amazing, because you never know what you went through in the past. And that's what's going to basically define your future if you don't change it or if you don't want to change it.
Right. And I think this is a great point, Diana, because let's not dismiss the fact that this is painful work. It is. I made a blog about this a couple of weeks ago, the successful failure. Like you're successfully pursuing your dreams. You're putting in the work. You're not sitting around waiting for someone to bring it to you.
Yes.
You're putting in the work. You're getting out there. So it is, it's a painful and lonely journey. Mm-hmm. But this is why you have to spend a lot of time programming yourself internally, meditation, yeah. journaling, affirmations, making sure you surround yourself by other like-minded women that could get you what you need when you're down and support mm-hmm. you when you're up, right? Because it's a journey, man. It's not a race. And there's days where you're looking around and you're like, wow, this is finally all coming to, it's all making sense. Like the opportunities yeah. are coming and it's happening. And then there's days that you're like, why am I even doing this? No one's even
yes.
doing this. You know? So yeah, you need a strong foundation. And unfortunately, sometimes our families don't have that. It's not that they don't want it. They don't want to. They just, it's not a part of them. You know, it's not part of their foundation. So how could they possibly pour into you? Again, going back to what I said earlier, fill your cup, right? So that you have so much more to hand out to the world and the next generations after. But if you're just like, you know, constantly running on empty and you're worried about what everyone else thinks, you're not going to meet your true purpose because you're just doing it for everyone else.
You mentioned the successful failure. Would you mind explaining that to our listeners?
Yes. So I had been at an event with some other Latino entrepreneurs and professionals. And we were sitting at a table talking about how we were reaching our goals, our career goals, our business goals, academic goals, and yet still feeling like we were a failure in the eyes of our traditional community or our parents, our families. And I gave some examples. I had a young lady who had decided not to have children. She's not married, doesn't have any kids. She has her own apartment and lives there with her cat and is happy as a clam. She loves her life, you know, and she's like, I've been trying to get into this MBA program, this master's program. And she had applied like multiple times, couldn't get in. And she tried other schools, couldn't get in. And she's like, I just really was so bummed. And I thought, I want to get into this master's program. Well, after grit and putting in time and working with an academic counselor and everything, she finally got in. And she was like so excited. She's like, oh my gosh, I'm going to get in. I got this. I start in the fall. I'm so excited. And we were all at the table. We're like, that's great. Like, good for you. That's awesome. Like, I must feel so great. She's like, yeah. And I went back to my dad. And my dad's like, oh, que bien, hija. Like, whatever. Like, if she bought a new pair of shoes. Like, she's like, I would have expected more enthusiasm, you know? And she goes, and then my mom was like, so does this mean that you're not going to give me any grandkids for how long is this program?
Oh my gosh.
Like, it's 2.5 years. And she's like, so does this mean that I'm not going to give any grandkids for another 2.5 years? And she's like, I'm not even married yet. And she's talking about grandkids. So again, like they don't understand. So in the world's eye, when she's in a room in front of other people and we're hearing she got into this MBA program, we're like, awesome girlfriend. Like, good for you. This is going to be amazing. You seem so excited. I celebrate with you. This is going to be great. And then she goes back to her family and it's like, what's the big deal? Like, so how is this going to impact my life? That's what I want to know. Like, you know, and it's
oh
just
my gosh.
Disconnect of I'm a successful failure. I'm successful in the academic career, you know, dream builder space, but in my family's eyes, I'm a failure because I think at the time I met her, 27, I think.
Okay.
Like, I'm 27. I don't have any children, and like my eggs are drying up.
You know, like, oh my God.
So I'm like, okay. Then I met another girl. She is in her master's program right now. She's not married, doesn't have any children. I think she's 24, but she still lives at home. And her dad is still telling her when to go and when to come, what time she needs to be home. Her brothers can do whatever she wants.
Oh, like always.
Right? And she's 24 years old and has a job and goes to school. But because she lives at home, her parents tell her when. And she's like, I'm fine with it because I live at home. Right? And so she's still, when she, I think she said she had applied for, when she got into her master's program, again, it was the question of, well, so now what? Like, so does that mean you're not going to, are you like not looking for men? And then it's so funny that during this, moms are like, so, ¿te gustan los hombres, verdad, hija? Are you going to tell me something? And they're like, no, mom. Yes, I like men. Like, you know, but it's like, what's something wrong with this? Because we don't pursue the obvious need to be someone's wife or need to be someone's mom. Right. And so, so she's like, I'm told what to do at 24. I'm like a child in my own life, but this is what I've accepted. And so in the real world, it's like, oh, you got into masters and you're working and, you know, you don't have a bunch of children, you know, and all that. No, it's like, somebody looks at her like, oh, you're a failure. Cause how old are you? You still live with your parents and you're not married. You don't have kids. Like,
yeah,
you know? So she's a successful failure. But I think the one that really got me that I hadn't heard in a while was I met a gentleman who is got a really prominent position in the university. He works for a university and he's doing major important work for like DACA students and, you know, and he's providing feedback on the curriculum and he's making moves and programs that help facilitate underprivileged children, students to be able to get access to training and coaching and tutors and things like that so that they can succeed in the academic space. And he didn't get here by chance. Like he's like, I've really struggled with life. You know, he said right out of high school, he got into drugs and alcohol. He had received a DUI at some point in his life, spent some time in jail. And, you know, he was living on people's couches at different times of his life. He was just kind of like lost. Right. And then it took you, I'm looking, sitting across the table from this man at this event and he's in a suit and he looks good. And he looks healthy. And I'm like, wow, that's a long way from what I see in front of me now. And he's like, oh yeah, I did a lot of work. You know, I worked on myself. I went to rehab and I got back into school and I just started taking control of my life. And now I have an apartment and he's single, no children. He's like, I have an apartment and I travel and I take care of myself and I go to work every day. I'm a productive member of society. But when I go home, my parents, his mother particularly makes him feel like you should be taking care of me. Like her friends are like, oh, so your son's a big hotshot at so-and-so university, but you're still working? You shouldn't be working anymore. Yeah. He should be taking care of you if he's so successful. So it makes him look selfish for not being able to support her financially. But he's like, Michelle, we live in Southern California. Everything's expensive out here. And I just literally learned how to take care of myself. And now I have this pressure to financially support her as well. Because of the work. So I did all this work to be successful and self-dependent, independent, and I'm still not enough because I'm a son and I should be taking care of her. I was like, wow, that's a lot for a male, a son to take on, right? And imagine if he was married.
I know. Oh my gosh.
You know, poor guy. And he's like, I'm a successful failure. He's like, it's really crazy to go into other places and people, you know, say such positive words to me about the work that I've done, the work that I'm doing. And yet I go home and I'm still not enough. Yeah. Like, wow, that's really, and he said the pain in his eyes. I was like, wow, that's really, so it's a painful journey, you guys. It really is. To be a Latino and decide I'm going to do it my way. And I'm going to probably piss and hurt people along the way. And I'm just going to have to be okay with that. You know, and hopefully find the time that, you know, later on in life, maybe things will be different. But right now at this stage, when you're 20s, 30s, you know, it's going to be, this is what it's got to be today. And I tell myself the same thing. I mean, I'm about my husband and my kids. that's my life. My husband, my kids, my business, my career, this is my life right now. And so, no, I don't go to every family event. I don't go see my mom every weekend. I don't call her every day. I don't go see my grandma every day. I may regret it. I don't know. All I know is that right now I have a 13-year-old and a 9-year-old that need me. So maybe once they're grown up and don't really need me every day anymore, then I can afford to go hang out for 2-hour coffee dates with my mom, or I can, you know, I can take her to all her doctor's appointments, or, you know, maybe at a later time in life, but that's not my life right now. And I have to do what's best right now. And so you have to do that for you too.
Exactly. Yeah. And I feel like everybody's definition of success is always going to be different. So even if it's somebody telling you like, oh, you know, you have this, but oh, you don't have this or whatever. But to you, if you feel like you, because you're the only one that knows the hard work that had to put into it to do it. So I feel like if you feel like you're successful and you feel like you accomplished your dreams and your goals, but there's something being like in the back of your mind that's like, oh, I'm not because of this or because of that. Like I say, you just be proud of yourself, you know, and it's easier said than done, obviously. But I feel like you should always like write your own version of success, because my version of success looks different from yours, from Michelle's, from Maria's, like from even my own sister, from my best friend, anything, you know, they look different. So we can't really compare ourselves to that. I think that's one of the reasons why they do that. Like maybe they compare themselves to, oh, mira, él le ayuda a su mamá and he does this and ya está casado or whatever it is. And it's like, no, that's not me though. You know, like you should love your kids however they want to be.
Right. And it's that's why there's a purpose behind the pain, is that now you know how that feels. So when it's your time to mother children of your own, you know, like, okay, I don't want to pass this on. This is one of the things I'm not taking in my basket. I will not take the Latina mother guilt. I will let my daughter and my son live according to their standards, because they could bring a lot of shame to me in so many ways, but they're not. They're going to school. They're working. You know, they're traveling. They're doing what they want to do. They're doing important work that's important to them, and I just need to respect.
Exactly. Time is changing.
Yes.
And with every change, people don't agree and sucks, but hey, just gotta move on. Keep doing it. Live your life.
All right. So where can our listeners go ahead and reach out to you if they like some suggestions or if they have questions for you, where can they reach out to you?
They can find me on Instagram. My Instagram handle is MG for my initials, Michelle Gomez, MG Success Coach. And if you want to get access to some of the trainings and resources that I share through my coaching programs, you can go to my website, which is www.michelle, middle initial M for Martha, gomez.com.
All righty. Well, Michelle, thank you so much for being here with us today. And if you guys have any questions, feel free to reach out to us.
Thank you guys for tuning in to our Insightful Babes podcast. Make sure to stay tuned every single Monday for a new podcast every week.
Okay, bye.